For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek.
Theology Lesson 12, the Doctrine of Justification. And we're going to start with question number 7. All right.
Close enough.
You were close. One book over, 1 Corinthians. And this question is, what is Jesus made unto us? It's kind of a weird question. When you think about it, what is Jesus made unto us? And there's so many different things, so many different ways you can answer that. But let's keep it to the doctrine of justification. Kind of gives us a little bit more dialed in. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse number 30 says, "But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption." So, what is Jesus Christ made unto us? And Paul is pretty specific right here. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us, he's very specific. Wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. That's what Jesus has made unto us. That's part of justification. Okay? Questions? Comments? And like I said, very specific as to what he is for us. Question number 8. Does justification by faith release us from the penalty of sin?
No. Yes. Wait a minute. There goes sticking my foot in my mouth.
Exactly. Hold on. Does it release us from the penalty of sin? Now again, this is one of those questions that's
tricky.
Do we answer one way or do we answer the other way? Well, let's look at our verses since we're really unsure, right? Let's look at our verses. John chapter 3, verse 16. Maybe these verses can give us some clarification. How's that? Illumination. Clarification. Justification. Oh, see, I'm just throwing cations out here. Okay.
Vacation.
seeing how many words in my vocabulary end with ation. Sorry, a little English humor there. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Does that answer our question?
Partially.
We'll continue on. John chapter 3, verse 18. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Now you got ready for the answer. Are you thoroughly confused?
Totally.
This is a two-part answer. There's two parts to this answer. The first, justification by faith does release us from the final, hold on, final penalty of sin. And that is death or eternal separation from God. So let's go back. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Okay? So, justification by faith does release us from the penalty of sin, because the penalty of sin is what?
Death.
Death, eternal separation from God. Okay? Now you're starting to see where John 3:16 and 3:18 comes into play, right? When you read this question and you look at that, you're like, huh? Second, this is the second part of the answer. Justification by faith does not release us from the earthly penalties of our sins. Okay?
That's not my first reaction, was not.
Right, when you're like, again, that's why there's two parts to this answer. Okay? And they're not contradictory. There is no contradiction here. Okay? When Jesus Christ died on the cross and we accepted him as our Savior, we have been given a new birth. Mm-hmm. And we've talked about his blood covers us. So when God the Father looks at us, he sees God the Son. Right? Mm-hmm. We've taken on Christ's DNA as far as God is concerned, right? Because he sees his blood. He sees his DNA. However, just because he's forgiven us of our sins does not mean he stops the penalties of our sins here on earth. Like what's that old saying? Oh, I believe God will save me. If I step off this mountain, God will save me and keep me from dying. God doesn't stop, stupid.
Exactly.
Okay? Let's be honest. Let's be honest with each other. God doesn't stop stupidity. We still have our free choice, free will. So, and here's another thing. I'll tell a little side note. A friend of mine was saved at a much later age in his life, and he's going through some medical treatments. And when I was talking to him about it, you know, praying with him and everything, and he told me, he said, well, to be honest, he said, this is a result of my sins many, many years ago, long before he had accepted Christ as Savior. He had done some things that caused him, and they directly linked it, caused him to have a form of cancer now. And he's like, you know, that's what happens. You sin, pay the consequences, right? You cheat on a test, you get caught, guess what? You failed the test. There's consequences for sin. Once we've accepted Christ our Savior, we are still going to pay those consequences for our sins now.
King David is a perfect example of that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. He paid the consequences. But not only did he pay the consequences, but his family did as well.
And the whole nation.
And the whole nation, yeah. And sometimes we don't think about it, but the consequences from our sin can affect others. Mm-hmm. Yeah, King David is a good example. A very good example. The nation of Israel suffered because of David's sin. Very good example. I didn't even think about that one. So everybody understand this question? Does justification by faith release us from the penalty of sin? Do we understand the answers to this?
Moses is another example.
True. That's true. Moses, because of his sin, or his disobedience of God. I mean, it's still a sin. Disobeying, still a sin, right? Didn't do what God told him to do. Because of his disobedience, he didn't get to go into the promised land. Now, God was a just God. And God loved Moses. God took him up on the mountain and showed him the promised land. He at least got to see it. He didn't get to go in, but he got to see it. You know, which is a lot more than any of the rest of the adults of the nation of Israel at that time got to do. Except for two. Joshua and Caleb. It's the only two adults that wandered in the wilderness they got to actually enter into the promised land. So, real quick, we're all...
Because the people sinned too by building the golden calf and all that.
Yeah,
they turned
because of all of everything that they had done throughout
the whole 40 years.
The whole 40 years in the wilderness, yeah. And their disbelief in God, right. All every time they turn around, and yeah. As soon as things got bad, they immediately turned on God. Again, consequences of their sins.
Each specific incident, like the golden calf that Katie mentioned, there was a retribution very soon after that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
When they got tired of the bread that God was providing, and they started complaining, well, we don't have any meat. Well, he sent the doves, and then the more they chewed, the more that it expanded in their mouth, and you know, those that had complained and belly ached the most,
they
killed them. Yeah. So their consequences many times was very
severe,
very severe, and very specific, and very quickly.
What about the poisonous adders?
Yeah, and the adders, that's right.
I mean, you know, they were very bitter against God, and God took care of it, right? But again, because of their sins and their unbelief,
mm-hmm.
You know. But through all of that, Moses, you'd think, was still, right? Because he hadn't turned away from God. He hadn't disobeyed God up until the time he struck the rock.
He let his temper get the best of him.
Yeah, he let his temper get the best of him. And can any of us say that?
Of course.
Yes.
I'm trying to hide my hand over here. But we've all let our temper get the best of us, right? And what happens when we let our temper get the best of us? Usually, we do something or say something, and guess what? We have to pay for that in some shape, form, or fashion. There's a price. We always suffer the consequences. But once we've accepted Christ as Savior, we don't suffer the penalty. And so there's another thing I want to make clear. Two words. And again, this is part of being very specific with our wording. Penalty, consequences. Okay? Penalty is final. Done. Over with. It's the final, right? Consequences are not the final. Does that make sense? Yes, ma'am.
Consequences, unfortunately, builds upon the other, and builds on the other, and on the other. It's like that gentleman with what he did when he was younger. It led up to the cancer that he had.
Mm-hmm.
And all of that was a consequence, but it all had a pattern. This leads to this, this leads to this, this leads to this, and it's just, and it's a predictable. It's a predictable pattern. Yes, people say, well, it's, but it's always going to have this kind of a pattern. And so it's like, people haven't seen that, haven't grasped that. When they don't grasp it, it doesn't mean that it doesn't happen.
Agreed. Any other questions, comments? All right. Question number 9. Will any who have been justified ever be lost? And this is another question. Is there, Read it a second time. Read it a third time. It's like, okay, forget it. I can't figure out the answer to this. Let me go to the verses.
Question.
Well, no. You can't answer a question with a question. No. That's not the way it works.
Comment.
Okay.
A comment.
Okay, all right, good.
To be justified, you have to know Jesus Christ as your Savior.
Right.
And if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you won't be lost.
Right.
Right.
So.
They'll put a butt in there.
I'm not putting a butt in there. Right.
Thanks, Mr.
So, when you're looking at the question, like I said, you read it through and you're like, huh? Read it through a second time. What? You start to put the words in place. Again, like you said, justified means accepting Christ as your Savior, right? Remember, we use justified in the doctrine of justification. It's used two different ways. Okay? So you've got to put it in, how is justification being used in this question? And then lost. Does lost mean unsaved? Or does lost mean I need a map? Okay? So let's look at what answers we've got here. Psalms chapter 37. Sorry, it's not chapter, but I always say chapter because it just throws me off if I don't. Psalms 37, let's turn to verse 23 through 24. For such, if I would be on the right verse. 23, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his hand. The good man, speaking of here, is the saint. Saved individual. Because if you go back to verse 22, and verse 21, and verse 20, and verse 19, and 18, and again, keeping the verse in context, okay? Sometimes you got to go back all the way to the beginning of the chapter. Sometimes you got to go to the chapter before, right? To get context about whom is being spoken to, about what is they're speaking, right? To take the five rules of interpretation into context, to keep the verse in context, when you go back, the steps of a good man, saved individual, justified individual, are ordered by the Lord. The Lord tells us how to live. He tells us what to do. He lays our path out for us. We just got to follow it. Broad is the way, but narrow is the way unto salvation, right? He delighteth in his way. He, being the good man, delighteth in his being Lord, God. So the steps of a good man, steps of the justified, are ordered by the Lord. And the justified delighteth in the Lord's way. If you really want to break it down. Though he, justified, fall, the justified shall not be utterly cast down. In other words, if we sin, we're not going to be cast down. For the Lord upholdeth the justified in the Lord's hand. Again, remember, just because we fall down doesn't mean we don't suffer the consequences of it. It doesn't mean the Lord doesn't take the rod to our backsides, right? And chastise us. Just because he chastises doesn't mean he lets go. So, the answer, I think we already answered it, but we'll be clear. No. All who have been justified will always be saved. When God said everlasting life in John 3:16, He meant everlasting. I thought if I put little spaces in there, it would look kind of ridiculous, but He meant everlasting. Always, forever and ever, amen. Any questions? No? All right. We'll continue. Number 10, is the believer justified from all things? Is the believer saved from all things? I'm telling you, these questions are make you think, which is what we're here for. We're here to think. We're here to learn. Not just you guys, but me too. Because I have to ask these questions myself first before I can try to explain the answers to y'all, right?
But you'd be surprised if there'd be people that'll ask you these questions. They don't realize that it's a deep question. They just get to thinking and they're like, well, what about?
And they may not use the word justified, mm-hmm. right? But they may be asking the same exact question, a little bit different wording, right?
Right.
But this is what they're asking. Another way of asking this question is, so if someone who's saved, they're saved from everything. They're free of all, right? Does that make sense?
And that's when they start saying, well, what about the man who murders?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Are they free from all that? Right?
Yes.
And that goes back to question number 8. Does justification by faith release us from the penalty of sin? Yes, but not the consequences. All right, so I mean, again, when they go from this, you answer this question, then they go into another question. See how all these questions, they build upon each other, but they're helping us with the mindset of understanding what a lost person will ask us. Okay? And help us understand how to answer or combat it. And I say combat because we are at war. We're at war with the devil and his forces every day. I'm sorry people don't like it, but God is love and all that is great, but we've got to remember, people, we are at war. We are soldiers fighting in the Lord's army. Love that song when I was a kid. I will never march in the enemy, ride in the cavalry, shoot the artillery. I will ever fly o'er the enemy, but I'm in the Lord's army. Yes, sir! Alright? I thought that was just the coolest song growing up.
Yeah.
But there's biblical doctrine behind it. When you look at Ephesians, and Paul talks about armor. Why does he talk about armor? Because we are soldiers. And that's what we're doing. We're learning to fight. We're learning how to fight. Acts chapter 13. Turn your Bibles to Acts chapter 13. I do ask that you turn because even though I do try my best to make sure I have it right, I do make mistakes. As we've all learned in this classroom. Acts chapter 13, verses 38 and 39 says, be it known unto you therefore, men and brethren, that through this man, Christ, is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. And by him all that believe are justified from all things from which ye could not be justified by the law of Moses. by him, Christ, all that believe are justified from all things. Saved from all things. So, yes, when we believe on the everlasting Son of God and accept him as our Savior, we are justified from all things. Saved from all things. Pretty simple. Pretty easy. And then they go to question 8. You answer this question, then they go to question 8.
Again.
Does justification by faith release from the penalties of sin? But they ask it in a different way, just like you mentioned. Well, what about this person? What about this person? What about this person? The answer is still the same. We're justified from all things. Saved from all things. Saved from all sin. Because no matter what we do, God sees the blood. Okay? But now, I love that question. But what about those who do bad things? And see, this is where the human mind goes with having to do extra to stay saved. Right? Because in our mind, we struggle with the fact that it's free. Do nothing of our own. You see what I'm saying? And that's why people call Baptists crazy. What do you mean it's free? Well, if it was free, then that's just a license to sin. You ever heard that? Mm-hmm. I'll put it to you like this. I have a handgun permit. Gives me a license to carry a handgun. Okay? But does it give me a license to use that handgun?
Not to.
However I want to do it? Huh?
Not to take another life.
Doesn't give me a license to use it at all, actually. Believe it or not. I don't have a license to use my handgun. I have a license to carry my handgun. If I use it to shoot a post, there may be consequences. If I walk in the woods and I shoot it in a tree in the woods, there may be consequences. Right? Just because I have that license doesn't mean I have a license to use it.
You're not bond, you don't have a license to kill.
Exactly.
But like you say, it's shooting it into a post. I kind of get it. Like I know it's...
Yeah, because it can strike off and hit somebody else.
Right. I know it's against the law, especially in the city limits. I don't know about out in the woods. Why would it be...
Any round that comes from my handgun, I'm responsible for.
Okay. Like she said, it could bounce off and hit somebody
else.
Yeah,
hit somebody else, or... I shoot that tree, and a piece of it comes back and hits me, or something, a tree comes back and hits me, and I go to the hospital, and they find out it's from a gunshot, I can get in trouble for shooting myself.
I got you.
You realize that?
Yeah.
Kind of stupid, but, you know, it's like, okay, so you shot yourself. You know you could actually go to jail for shooting yourself. Okay? Or be fined for shooting yourself. Right? But like I said, it seems ridiculous. But the point I'm trying to make here, and hopefully I'm not, chasing rabbits here. But the point I'm trying to make is just because we've accepted Christ as our Savior does not give us a license to sin.
Because you are still accountable, just like you're accountable for every bullet that leaves your gun. or doesn't leave your gun.
Right.
We are still accountable as children of God for what we do or do not do.
Correct. We're accountable to God. So everything we do, yes, we will not lose our salvation. Okay? I'm going to be very clear. Regardless, once you've accepted Christ as your Savior, it doesn't matter what you do. You could be Hitler, and you would not lose your salvation. Okay? But there will be consequences. Brother Vernon talks a lot about the great white throne judgment and the judgment seat of Christ. Okay, he's been talking a lot about that. Great white throne judgment for the lost, judgment seat of Christ for the saved. To be honest, I'm not a theologian, so I don't know enough about the judgment seat of Christ to say he's going to judge us on our sins or he's going to judge us on what we did or did not do for him. I don't know. I don't know enough. I can't give you an answer on that. Let me study on it for a while and pray on it, and maybe we'll have an answer for you. But I don't have an answer for you on that. My limited understanding of the judgment seat of Christ right now, you'll be judged on what you did or did not do for Christ. Not necessarily your sins that you've committed as a saved individual, but you had this opportunity and you did not. Like I said, I may be wrong. This is all my thinking, okay?
That's definitely part of it.
I mean, I haven't studied enough to really give you a good answer. That's just very simply. But just because we've accepted Christ as our Savior does not give us a license to sin. There are consequences.
Many people overlook the fact that once you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, your desire changes.
Mm-hmm.
That's
true.
You no longer desire to do a lot of the things that you've done before. You may do them because we are still in the flesh, and the flesh might overrule or take the upper hand, but the desire of the redeemed spirit is in line with what God wants.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't always happen, but to get the desire has been changed dramatically.
And sometimes the flesh is, what did Paul say? The things I do not want to do, that I do. The things I want to do, that I don't.
I don't.
You know? And Paul was one of the most mature Christians I could think of, right? And if one of the most mature Christians that I could ever think of would struggle with that, why would we not struggle with that? Why would a young child of God not struggle with that? You know what I mean? Regardless of what you're going through, there is still the flesh. And we talked about that in previous lessons. There is still the flesh. We are still going to sin. Our heart's desire is not to. And that's where we have to follow the leadership of the Holy Spirit. I think I have time for one more. And I'm going to try to hurry up and get this one in because we still got to go to 16 by the end of the year. So we got to roll right along. Number 11, who purchased the sinner's justification? You said we'd be in Romans. Here we are. We're back in Romans again. Romans chapter 3, verses 24 through 26. Being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in His blood, to declare His righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say, at this time His righteousness, that He might be just and the justifier of Him who which believeth in Jesus. Said all that to say this: who purchased our justification? Sinners, ours, all of us. Every man, woman, child, jackrabbit of us. Jesus Christ, or Christ Jesus, purchased our justification through his death, burial, and resurrection. No other price could pay that which was paid. Yes, ma'am.
On the reason you would put Christ Jesus, Christ meaning King.
King Jesus, yeah. That's
so
true.
You're elevating him to the position that he has, and that's the reason that you would want it that way.
Yeah, but it's funny when you, it's funny because sometimes he does it, Christ Jesus, and then if you look over in chapter 5 and verse number 11, he says, and not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. Okay? So, he words it differently, but again, like you mentioned, he's putting emphasis. And in this verse, he's emphasizing Christ Jesus. You know? And so, words mean a lot. The placement of words mean a lot. That old saying, I'm sure you heard it when you was your kid, and I'm sure you've told your children this before, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Not so true.
Right.
That
can definitely
not so
hurt.
True. Mm-hmm. And words can do more damage than sticks and stones, right, a lot of times. And see, that thought, sticks and stones will never hurt me, that thought is how Satan gets around God's word. Okay? Because what does Proverbs say about a fool? About a wise man keepeth his mouth shut? Right? But a fool runneth his mouth all the time? Okay? When you're running your mouth, what's coming out?
Stupid. Words.
Words. Stupidity. I mean, you know, all these apply. But why would we have this famous saying, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me, when God's word says the opposite? You ever thought of that? Think about it logically, you know words can hurt. But why would that be drummed into our head as a young child? As a young child, I can say whatever I want to say. It's not my problem if they don't like it. Heard that one?
Yeah.
Doesn't matter what I say as long as it's the truth. Whose truth? That's my favorite one when I hear that. Whose truth? What you think is true? Or what you can prove to be true? Because how many times we hear the truth in the media and then wait.
They leave out one little bit that changes the meaning all the way.
And it's a lie. Okay? I mean, we're seeing this over and, I mean, you're seeing this pattern. But it starts back from that whole mindset of words don't hurt. And then we've gone to the totally flip side of this. I need safe spaces from other people's words. Because now we went from words don't hurt to words are the most harmful thing ever. Okay? It's like how you can't have it both ways, people, right? Anyway, sorry, I didn't mean to get off our subject here. But Christ Jesus purchased our justification. through his blood. No other price could pay that which was paid. And that is where we are going to stop. Number 11.